Good evening, everybody. My name is Martin Dare, and I'm the Chief Negotiator for the Anishinabek Nation Governance Agreement. I'd like to begin our evening by acknowledging our Eagle staff over there, and also by reciting our Negotiator Anishinabek. The purpose of our Negotiator Anishinabek is it's the preamble to our Anishinabek Nation Chinooktegay, when it was developed by our elders and is an important part of our Chinooktegay, and was also incorporated to many of our First Nations Chinooktegay. So with that, I'll recite the Negotiator Anishinabek. Grebenjigetigisan Anishinabek, King Kibigidwanda Gandana Nido Wadziwin. Shkude Be Ke Nodin, Kibigidosonan Winagwen Mampishkagamagin. Grebenjiget Kiminagwenchtagwenda Wat Anishinabek Wan Nunjodwind, Linda Nijwasa Kinamadunan. Zagedwin, Debwewin, Nandenmowin, Bakawin, Dabenziwin, Wekwadzin, Mino Akdewin. Debenjiget Kiminguna, Debenwe, Minagdwenwin. Kanandendana, Gabajwebuk, Mino Nogomegoezwebuk, Mino Gabe, Wanajwebuk. Ah, Miwech.
Miwech Martin. I said, Bonjour, Anin. Ani kwe kwe, hey. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our second Facebook Live Q&A roundtable podcast on the Anishinabek Nation Governance Agreement. I'll be your moderator for tonight. My name is Mary Laronde. I'm from the Atamagui Anishinabe, and my clan is Wabijishi and Ndoda. So joining me tonight on our panel, I'll do the introductions. We'll be providing you with some insight into the governance agreement, telling you about what it is about and what it is not about as well, and conversely. And so to my right, as Martin had introduced himself, is our chief negotiator, Martin Baer. Martin is a lawyer of many years who is from Ondik Omnikaning on Manitoulin Island. And beside Martin is Lake Huron Regional Chief Scott McLeod. And I'd also like to say hello to Scott, Chief McLeod, and also to say thank you for having us here on Nipissing First Nation territory. And to his right is Southeast Regional Deputy Grand Council Chief James, or as we call him, Jim Bob Marsden. So welcome, gentlemen, and thank you for joining us tonight. So, as we will be telling you tonight, or our panelists will explain, that the Anishinabek Nation Governance Agreement has been a long journey, started in 1995, and over the past 25 years has been a work in progress between the Anishinabek Nation, the representative First Nations, and Canada. So, in next month, it'll be coming down to the ratification vote, where eligible voters from participating First Nations will cast their ballot, either in person by mail-in ballot or electronically by e-vote. So last year, and carrying into 2020, there have been dozens of public information sessions, shared communications, and hundreds of documents distributed to help explain what the agreement is all about and what it will mean for the Anishinabek Nation. And there have been many questions and comments about the agreement posted on social media. So tonight, with the help of our panelists, we hope to address those questions and any questions that are coming in tonight over the wire, I suppose. So feel free to post your inquiries, and we will do our best over the next little while to answer them for you. So to start things off, we have put together a list of some of the questions that have been circulating. And so I was wondering if anyone would like to begin with some of the questions until we get some of our questions in from our audience tonight.
Sure. Okay, I guess, so I'm Chief McLeod here at Nipissing, and we do have some of the questions in front of us here on the agreement, and I'll start with the first one. It reads, the agreement will give chiefs more power and money which won't benefit citizens or communities. So I guess that's more of a statement than a question, but this is false. Chiefs will still be accountable to the citizens of their communities just as they have always been. Their citizens will also help decide on how the money is to be utilized. First Nation governments will operate according to their constitutions if they haven't already developed them, which they'll be developing and ratifying by the citizens. Secondly, the agreement doesn't do anything the existing Indian Act or current legislation doesn't do. Again, this is false. The Anishinaabeg Nation Governance Agreement provides an unprecedented level of funding and autonomy that no Canadian legislation does within the four areas of governance jurisdiction. The next one, the UI, Union of Ontario Indians, is going to become the government. This is also false. The First Nations that ratify the agreement will form a collective, and that collective is going to be known as the Anishinaabeg Nation Government. The government will have complete control of all funding. The UOI, or the Union, will remain the secretariat for the 39 Anishinaabeg First Nations. Next, the agreement doesn't do anything for Anishinaabeg language or culture that isn't already happening. Again, this is false. It provides stable funding to strengthen and promote languages and culture, and the jurisdiction to develop laws and policies surrounding language and culture. The inclusion of lawmaking authority for languages and culture reflect the highest priority stated by the Anishinaabeg people during the extensive consultation over the past 25 years. Next, the Anishinaabeg Nation doesn't properly inform voters. Again, this is false. The communication efforts have been lengthy and extensive. There have been numerous information sessions in communities, urban centers, etc. Communications coordinators specifically hired to inform and engage community members have been hired in most communities, providing a wide range of information. Experts on the agreement have spoken to hundreds of Anishinaabeg Nation members explaining the agreement's process and benefits. Agreement information is free and available to anyone requesting copies of the agreement.
So we have this question, we have two questions in. The first one, which I will refer to the panel, is what about our treaties? Will the Anishinaabeg Nation Governance Agreement affect any ongoing treaty processes?
Okay, maybe I could respond to that question, Mary. So first of all, within the agreement, there's very specific language that says that this agreement is not intended to abrogate or derogate in any way from the Aboriginal treaty rights that are recognized in Section 35 of the Constitution Act. So the reason we put that in there was to make sure that the Government of Canada couldn't use this agreement to say that somehow it fulfilled a treaty obligation it had. We also made sure that this wasn't going to be a discussion about our treaties. It was simply an agreement by Canada that provides the recognition of the four lawmaking powers that are set out in the agreement, that is the power to enact election laws and language and culture laws, citizenship and management and operation of government-type laws. So it's not the agreement's not intended to affect any existing treaty rights or any ongoing treaty discussions.
Thank you, Martin. Would you like to add anything to that, Chief McLeod?
Well, in our territory, the Robson Huron treaty area, you know, we are doing our own work outside of this agreement. One does not really affect the other, and this is more about laws within the community and not so much treaty or treaty negotiations or treaty issues that that may arise. Those still are still going to happen, and we're forming the body that's going to deal with those. But this agreement doesn't address or interfere with that whatsoever.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think most of our First Nations in the nation have been dealing with land claims and treaty issues way before we started talking about the self-governance policy stuff. But so that's why these safeguards are in place. For we got to see all these issues through. It's a separate table.
Mm. Great, thank you. So I also I have another question here, and this one is about the fiscal agreement. And so the question is, can you explain the fiscal agreement? Will a First Nation that ratifies get 7 times the band support funding annually, or is it a one-time payout?
Okay, maybe I'll attempt to answer that question. So the fiscal agreement is the companion agreement to the Anishinaabek Nation governance agreement, and it's the agreement which provides the financial principles by which the funds would flow from Canada to the Anishinaabek Nation, then to the First Nations. And there's really two components to it. First of all, it's a 5-year term, so it's the first term of the fiscal transfer agreement is 5 years. And during that, just after the effective date, there'll be two categories of funding that'll be provided. One will be funding in order to perform the functions under the governance agreement, the functions such as holding council meetings and community meetings. It'll replace the band support funding and band employee benefits funding, and it could be up to 7 times the amount of what First Nations get now. And the two categories of funding are, the first one is the funding to support the functions under the agreement and the activities, and that those amounts are, each community would have a very specific amount, but they'll be no less than $1.7 million per year for the 5-year term of the agreement for each community. It'll be no less than that. In fact, many of the communities will receive slightly higher than that. And then the second component is there's a one-time, that first amount is payable every year for the 5-year term of the agreement. But the second amount, which is the amount for implementation, is $548,000. So every community that ratifies the agreement will receive $548,000 for implementation to start to put in place the laws that are provided for in the agreement, you know, whether it's an election law, Ben-Dungsijik law, or a language and culture law, or financial management act. That's what the implementation money pot is for, the $548,000, and then the second amount is the $1.7 minimum per year for the 5-year term of the agreement. So in a nutshell, that's kind of what the fiscal agreement is about, and those are the related funding flows that come with it.
Thank you, Martin. So we also have another question here. Did you have something you wanted to say about the fiscal arrangements?
No, I think Martin covered it well. So, but to put it plainly, I guess the question was: is it one time, or is it based on a yearly thing? And as Martin stated, it's yearly.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. So then we have our third question of the night: if the Anishinaabek Nation governance agreement passes, how does a First Nation leave the agreement after the fact? So I'm assuming if a First Nation ratifies the agreement, how does it leave the First Nation? I mean, how does it leave the agreement later, after the fact?
So within the agreement, there's a chapter that talks about how other First Nations can join, and it talks about the requirement to hold a ratification vote. In terms of specifics, in terms of how a First Nation leaves the agreement, we purposely left that blank because the First Nation is but decides to leave the agreement after it's ratified. Let's say it's lived under the agreement for 3 or 4 years and isn't really turning out the way it expected, then it's open for communities to pull out and leave if they want. And the way they leave is left up to the First Nation. So, for example, the First Nation can leave by, maybe passing a band council resolution saying that it wishes to withdraw from the agreement at this time, or it could have another referendum in the same fashion that it had a referendum to approve the agreement. It could have a referendum among the people where they're asked on whether or not they want to withdraw from the agreement. So really, it's really those, you know, two processes, or maybe some other third process that, you know, we're not aware of. But once that happens, it would notify the First Nation would notify the First Nation, and we would notify Canada, and then the appropriate adjustments would be made to provide for the withdrawal of that First Nation.
Okay, and we have another question coming in, so good. Okay, so I'm not sure if this is going to be answerable, but when you say seven times higher funding amounts, that is, what are we getting now? Each res is different depending on its banned list. So each community is different depending on its banned list. It's sort of a, it's almost, I don't know what community we're talking about, but maybe you have an example of a sort of an X community?
Well, so on average, I would say that right now, many of our First Nations likely receive between 200,000 and 400,000 annually to perform governance functions or governance activities. Some communities get a lot less than 200,000. Some get, you know, 150,000, 175. It really varies by community. And so under the agreement, when the First Nation ratifies the agreement, those amounts will go up to no less than 1.7 million a year for 5 years. And 5 years, and like I said earlier, the amount that it'll increase by would be slightly above 1.7, but it'll never be below 1.7. And many communities will, you know, will get 2.1 million, 2.3. It really depends on the specific community. So on average, the funding will go up sevenfold in the sense that right now the collective amount that our First Nations get overall for governance funding is about 16.3 million, which is split among 40 First Nation communities. And if all 40 of our member First Nations ratify the agreement, that'll be increased to 96.8 million. So it would represent a sevenfold increase in the funding that's available to First Nations to perform governance functions and do the things that the agreement provides for, like enacting the laws that are recognized under the agreement.
So we're not having any. I think we're having a question come in, so perhaps we might want to go to the next page of some of the questions. Oh, here we are. We have a question coming. Thank you. Bear with us. Okay. We have three here. So, will creating a citizenship law allow some people to become status Indians?
I'll try that.
Okay.
Back in 96, there was seven of our First Nations in another process, and in 2004, when it came to ratification, I was chief of Alderville at the time, and we pulled out on the advice of our elders and some of our citizens that a nation cannot be a nation if they can't determine their own citizenship. So that was one of the main reasons Alderville pulled out of that other process. But in this process, each First Nation of the 40 can determine their own law on citizenship. So I know many of our First Nations under the court cases that have been won, S3 I believe, we're still seeing families having to appeal because they've been turned down by Indian Affairs. So I think for the First Nations that make up their own citizenship law, that'll give us the authority to determine who our citizens are. There's enough, that's my thought on it anyway.
I guess just to add to that, when we're talking about citizenship, and status, I think we have to realize that they're two separate things. Status comes out of the federal legislation of the Indian Act, and that's not what this agreement is. However, in order to get control of determining who, and when we say status, what we're really talking about is the fiduciary responsibility of the federal government to pay for education, health care, those kinds of things. So when we're talking about getting that back into our power so we can tell them who they need to be accountable to, I think the first step in doing so is creating citizenship laws so we ourselves can determine who our citizens are and let the government know that these are our citizens. And then we can start to build a case towards pressuring them to create or provide the fiduciary dollars to support them through education or whatever. But it starts here. It isn't necessarily talking about status, but this is the path that we're going on, where we can start talking about that in the future. And you know, our laws for our citizens could be the one parent rule. That could be the laws for our membership list. Whether or not the federal government recognizes that right now is one thing, but I think as we move forward in this and in regaining some of our control of our own citizenship laws and other areas of governance, we're going to build a strong case for that.
And then one more comment. Recently I did a trip to the Navajo Nation in, back in November, and their citizenship law for the Navajos is if you can show that you're one quarter blood Navajo, it's the Navajo Nation that determines that. They'll make you their member of the nation, not the U.S. government. And that's what we're trying to hope for with our government. Will determine.
Well, just as Chief McLeod said, we're hoping with this citizenship lawmaking power and the development of the citizenship lists afterwards that we can get back to a time when we determine for ourselves who our citizens were, because we used to do that. Chief McLeod talked about the ongoing litigation involving the signatory First Nations to the Robinson-Huron Treaty of 1850, and I like to use the example of the Robinson-Huron Treaty, in fact. So it was negotiated in 1850, and it provides for an annuity, and that's what the fight in court was about, was the trying to come to a proper resolution of what the amount of the annuity should be. But the point I want to make is that when the treaty was signed in 1850 and the Indian agents and Crown agents came around to pay the annuity that was due to the Indian people under the treaty, it didn't come with a preconceived list, or it didn't have a registry list of Indians who were entitled to the annuity payment. It asked the people, it asked the chiefs and the principal headmen and the leaders of the community, it's asked, well, who are your Indians? Who do we owe this annuity to? And over time, that got expensive for the British Treasury, because keep in mind, Canada doesn't come around until 1867, and so the obligation to pay the annuities was left to the British Crown, and so it needed ways to reduce its treaty obligations, the amounts of the annuities, and that's why the Indian Act came around in 1876, and all of a sudden you had all these arbitrary or discretionary ways that people could be removed from the list of who was entitled to treaty annuity payments. And so, you know, that's what we're trying to get back to, is to a time where we determine who our citizens were, and we tell the government who is owed the annuity and who is entitled to other benefits that are provided for and protected in the treaty. So, you know, Chief McLeod is right. It's not going to give us the power to determine who our status Indians are, but it is going to give us the power to determine who our citizens are, and we'll use that power in the development of our citizenship list to then press the government to recognize all of the people that are on the citizenship list after.
Oh, very rich. Thank you very much for the very thorough answer. I'm just going to take these questions in the order that they come in, whether some of them are end up being a little bit repetitious. I really don't have ability right now to put those together that way. So the next question we got, in order of receipt of them, is outside of the negotiation team, who else was involved in this process over 25 years?
Well, I guess being the lead negotiator on that, I can answer that question. So for many years, well over 20 years, we would meet in our communities, and community members would come out to the meetings and take part in the conversations and share their ideas. Over the years, we had a governance working group, so it was comprised of people from our communities, members of our communities who sat on the governance working group, and we would meet at least four times a year. And so that turned out to be a real valuable forum for getting input into the development of the agreement, getting feedback on provisions we had drafted and were tabling for Canada's consideration. We had numerous regional chiefs meetings in our various regions. We had meetings among our Grand Council, so twice a year we'd have reporting to our Grand Council Assembly. We had a Chiefs Committee on Governance. So over the years we had many people who would be part of this and fed into the development of the agreement, some of whom are no longer with us. But over the course of 25 years, there were probably hundreds of people that fed into the development of the agreement.
Thank you. Did anyone else like to add anything to the involvement maybe of your own community in some of these processes?
Well, I think in like even lately, some of the like the summit, for example, where we had some of the grassroots people there participating and really kind of etching out what this governance system can look like, because there's a lot that is left up to the nations themselves to determine. And so things like incorporating the principles of the clan system into a modern day governance approach was one of the big things that came out of that, with of course our elder Gord Windebens leading that. But it's all those things that were questions a year ago. How is this going to look? And I think if we had just come to the people with something ready made, that wouldn't be fair to them. So I think it's a good exercise to include the grassroots people on how this is going to look. Now I think we're aware of the fact that we can't go back 400 years ago and have the exact same clan system in today's modern world, but we can glean from the clan system the values and the principles behind the way our government used to work, and apply those to more of a modern day governance system. And it's things like that include the grassroots people. And also I have to also just mention, one of the questions that I had last night in the community meeting was a very good question, was, why did this just come out of nowhere and all of a sudden we're agreeing on this? But the fact of the matter is, a lot of people, may not have heard of this, but after 25 years of working on this, it kind of became a bit of a wallflower. And it was always going on in the background, and even here at the head offices of the union, it just seemed like a department now, because it's been here so long, it just became office furniture. And so it's not like we haven't you know, it haven't seen it before, or it's crept up on us. It's been there. I think, you know, it's up until now where we're really deciding on whether we ratify this thing or not. It's come to the forefront again, and it's not new, but you know, it's like, you know, an old T-shirt that you had in your closet, and you take it out, and you know, I forgot I had this. Same kind of thing, and you know, it has been here, and there's a lot of people, as Marty said, that have worked on this over the years, some of which are not with us anymore. But and this was mandated, you know, 25 years ago by the chiefs of the time to get this done. So this just didn't come out of something that the Union of Ontario Indians concocted up. It was something that the chiefs wanted at the time, and I think one of the reasons it took so long to get to this point was the political environment changed while this was going. So the agreement had to change with the times, and it slowed the process down.
Oh, just for a bit of a memory, back in '96, what I mentioned before, Mary, there was seven of our First Nations in the Southeast region. We were under the United Anishinabek Council self-government process, but all seven, we still did BCRs participating in the, back then it was the Union of Ontario process. Mm-hmm. So we were running parallel. So in 2004, none of the communities ratified the UAC process, but the remaining six were still participating in our Anishinaabeg Nation, right up to the education agreement and the governance. Mm-hmm. So, you know, a lot of our First Nations have been in this process for many, many moons. So,
and if I may, just to add to that, is that because I was a staff person for a long time from the beginning of the process until 2016, we have records, you know, of all the people that we talked to, and many various venues and different kinds of workshops and conferences, elders, youth, women, all the different sectors in our communities involved in this process. And so when we were keeping the records of how many people signed up or how many people were contacted each year with involved in these processes, there were 4,000 people approximately every year that came to workshops, conferences, and working groups, and we had a policy body as well guiding the negotiations of the Chiefs Committee on Governance, which was made up of the chiefs from all of representing all the regions. So I just thought I would mention that, and we do have this book that we did with the basically of 10 years of intensive consultations when we had community facilitators. And this information is could be available to you if you wanted to see what the people were saying. Okay, so on to the next question is, if the Anishinaabek Nation governance agreement passes, the federal government will make a one-time governance implementation contribution of $548,000. How will governance be supported when Canada's funding runs out? That sort of supposes that the funding is going to run out. So maybe I'll turn that over to Martin in terms of what the funding agreement says.
So the $548,000 that each community will receive when it ratifies the agreement will be used to support the implementation of the agreement and to help to develop and pass the laws that are recognized under the agreement. But the other core funding for governance will continue, the First Nations will continue to receive that, so it's not going to run out. It'll be payable in annually and for the first 5 years of the agreement, and then in year three of that five-year term, we would start negotiating the next agreement, and it may not be 5 years, it could be longer than that. If we don't reach an agreement on the next fiscal term, then the one that we have in place just continues, and the funding levels will flow according to the agreement that we're operating under or that the First Nations will be operating under at the time. So two things. One, the 548,000, that's a one time, so the First Nations will just receive that, you know, after the effective date, and then they'll also receive the, you know, the, again, it varies, but it'll be no less than 1.7 million a year for the 5-year term of the agreement, and that's the amount that'll continue to flow every year thereafter.
I'll be back to Martin. So our next question is, this is a sort of a repeat question, thank you, but I know that people are just probably, you know, signing on and coming and going, so we'll put the question to the panel again, which is, why does the Anishinaabek Nation Governance Agreement not cover anything in regards to lands, resources, or treaties?
Well, I think it was Chief McLeod that mentioned earlier tonight that you know, how these negotiations got underway in 1995 was by a Anishinaabek Nation Grand Council resolution, which gave us the mandate to just look at these four lawmaking powers. So just, you know, we were asked to look at, back in 95, just to look at elections or leadership selection, language and culture, citizenship, and then, you know, management and operation type law. So that's why we just looked at those four areas, because that was the mandate we were given, and it was left for another day to look at some other jurisdictions, whether it's, you know, land and resource management, health, justice. And what we did though is we built a chapter into the agreement that essentially provided that, you know, at some point in the future, when the parties are willing to look at those areas, there's a whole framework that's laid out there, and it has a list of other possible areas that we might want to look at. And it was put in there so that when we look at the next jurisdictional sector, or if we look at the rest, we won't necessarily take 25 years this time to complete those. We won't have to do a framework agreement and an agreement in principle. It will be, process will be much much faster and smoother. That's why that chapter was put in there, was to provide that framework for negotiating, if the parties are willing, the next area that after governance and after education. So that was the rationale way back when we were working on that chapter.
And then, Mary?
Yes.
And then that would be called comprehensive, where everything is all into one bundle, mm-hmm. where we decided back then just to go the sectorial
mm-hmm.
approach. But I think what we're doing is we want to look at a list of the First Nations also. We have a number of the Anishinaabek Nations that signed on the lands management, for instance. Mm-hmm. How many of them have already pulled those pieces out of the Indian Act, right? And some are finance authority people, some First Nations are looking at. So right now we've got to make a list and see where all our First Nations are stacking up, because this is all forms of taking control of their own, right? Mm-hmm. So that's something to think, keep in mind also.
I think also just to add mm-hmm. to that, when you talk about lands and resources in that question, I'm assuming they're referring to lands and resources that are outside of the reserves, quote unquote, which are encompassed by treaties and in most areas. But in the Anishinaabek Nation, we're dealing with more than one treaty, so it becomes very complex. You got the Williams Treaty, you got the Robinson Huron Treaty, you got the Robinson Superior Treaty. You have unceded nations, so it's very complex. And I think it's incumbent to those groups to do what the Robinson Huron Treaty First Nations are doing, and start to organize themselves to deal with issues specific to treaties. And that's where this thing does not cross over to. So this is what we're talking about with this governance agreement, is lawmaking within our quote-unquote reserves.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes, that's... Thank you very much for that. Because this question was asked earlier, as I said, and it bears repeating, that it was very intentional that lands, resources, and treaties are not part of these negotiations. That was a very intentional way that we, that was our policy when we went forward into negotiations, that this was about governance matters that are in our communities, in our First Nations, the way that we govern ourselves and under whose authority. And we think that that can be our authority to do that, and that is our authority. So just, that was a repeat question, as I said. So number two on this particular list of questions, so this one is about explaining, can you explain the system of governance regarding representation? How will citizens choose their representation at chief and at the chief and council, at both at the local First Nation and also at the process of representation at the Anishinaabeg Nation?
Okay, so right now we the way our representatives of our First Nations are chosen, there's three ways. So first of all, there's by elections held under the Indian Act and conducted in accordance with Section 74 of the Indian Act. And just over half of our communities elect their leadership under the Indian Act with its limited two-year term of office. And you know, that creates a lot of turnover and a lot of instability in the sense that you're having an election every 2 years. In fact, we looked at this and were curious to see how many elections would take place over about an 8 month period. So from April of last year till November of last year, so April 2019 to November 2019, in that time period we had 18 elections, almost half of our First Nation membership had elections. So that's the first way people can choose their leaders and choose their representatives in the First Nation government. Some communities, a few communities, switched over to a First Nation election code. And so again, through the department's guidance, communities developed First Nation election codes, and some moved to three-year terms of office, others moved to four-year terms of office. And so that's the second way that leaders could be chosen at the First Nation level. Again, though, the power at the end of the day rests with the minister, in the sense that once the custom election code is completed, it has to be sent to Ottawa for review and approval. And then the last way that our community people can elect their leaders is under a piece of federal legislation called the First Nation Election Act. It's very easy to get in. You just pass a BCR. It provides for a four-year term of office, and once the BCR is passed, you're into that federal legislative recognition of how First Nation people can elect their leaders. So there's three ways right there. Going forward, though, under the election lawmaking power that's laid out in the agreement, communities can elect to in consultation with their people, develop new election laws, so they can, ask their people through, meetings, surveying, things like what term of office would they prefer? Would they prefer a two-year term, as is the case now under the Indian Act, or three-year term or four-year term? And people would be part of that process and be part of developing the law, and would check off the appropriate box that corresponds to their wishes. They could also do things like set the qualifications to run for a counselor or run for office of chief. So all those kinds of things that go into an election law. But the big difference is now is that those laws that are developed by the First Nation and the Anishinaabek Nation won't have to go to Ottawa for review and approval. Once it's passed by the community, then that's what's used to govern the elections going forward. So that's at the First Nation level. So it really, I guess in answer to the question, it really depends on what the election law looks like after, once it's discussed and deliberated by the people. And then similarly with the Anishinabek Nation law, that's the Anishinabek Nation election law, that'll set out how people can feed into the election of the, you know, the Grand Council Chief, the Deputy Grand Council Chiefs, and so on. So it really depends at the end of the day on what the two election laws look like, one at the First Nation level and then one at the Anishinaabeg Nation law, so election law. So that's how the representatives could be chosen going forward under this process.
But each First Nation has that right to make their own law.
Yeah.
They see it by what their citizens are saying.
Mm-hmm.
Also,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Also to add to that, just because Nipissing First Nation is going through the process right now, is that we've been a custom election code community now for I think it's been 15 years or better. But the thing we're going through right now is amending those. So as times change, some law election laws may be outdated or they need revising, whatever, but it's, you know, the powers within the community to undertake that through public consultation with their members and change the laws, to meet the changing times.
Okay, here's another one that is related to chief and councils, and it's, what's the plan to implement term limits and or boundaries for members looking to be a chief or council member for life? So it's kind of related to what you talked about terms, Martin, but so there's what's the plan to implement term limits or boundaries so that people aren't chief or council members for life?
So that's to, like, you know, decisions like that are not going to be made at the Anishinaabek level. Those are community decisions that are going to be done by each community. I guess if that's what one community wanted to do, terms for life, then maybe they could with their laws. But I guess the point is, that's up to the communities. It's not up to the Union of Ontario Indians or anybody else. Those powers are at the community level, and it's for each community to decide what their elections are going to look like and what the terms are going to look like, and not Indian Affairs or not the Union of Ontario Indians, but the community themselves.
Thank you.
Another point would be if maybe a community will say, make a law, we want you to vote right in the community instead of mail-in votes. You have to come right to say Alderville to vote in person. Mm-hmm. Or another community might say they'll accept online voting. So it's up to each community.
Thank you. Okay, so I have a couple here too that are related to to dollars. So let's put those together here so we can get these. I hope I don't lose track of where I am here. But we touched on this before, previously just tonight, but do more citizens equal more money from Indigenous Services Canada?
So in the first 5-year term of the fiscal agreement, it contains a number of escalators or factors that would trigger increase in the funding, and one of them is the increase in number of people, and the other one is inflation. So generally speaking, the more citizens, the more the funding would go up each year. So that's how it would work in the first 5-year term, and then after that, everything is on the table again. There'll be no less than 1.7 a year, 1.7 million a year for each First Nation going forward. But in terms of the term of the next agreement, it really is going to be depending on the outcome of the negotiations for the renewal of the funding agreement. And at that time, we would look at the populations of our First Nations and negotiate appropriate increases based on the increases that may have happened in the preceding 5-year period. So it generally speaking, would be yes, more funding, but again, it's all subject to negotiation.
Yeah, and to add to that, Marty, so this agreement is essentially setting a new minimum benchmark for band support funding,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
Which is the 1.7.
Yeah, so it'll be no less than that, but then right now that all of our First Nations in the first 5-year terms will get slightly more than that, and every First Nation received its letter of offer in the spring at the June Grand Council Assembly at Georgina Island, and so in fact, I think nobody's starting at 1.7, everybody's getting above that.
Mm-hmm.
But you're right, the 1.7 will be
is
the
minimum
floor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was done by formula, population part of it?
Yeah, formula, and also, though, it looked at the costs that any size government would need to have to in order to perform the responsibilities and obligations under the agreement. So, because the theory was a government, regardless of its size, First Nation government still has to do a certain number of governance functions and responsibilities, and so so we looked at that as well as population and other factors.
Okay, so thank you very much. Now we have a couple of questions here that are related to the Adib and Dodzig, the people that belong, and our citizenship, membership. Now, one of them is, you haven't spoken about people who live in urban centers and are not living on band land, or I guess in this case reservations. What are reserves, sorry. What are the benefits for those who do not live at home?
Well, so one of the powers that is recognized under the agreement is the power to enact new election laws, and so depending on how the law is framed, it would recognize the right of those that don't reside in the communities to take part in the elections. Obviously, they also have the right to be recognized as citizens under the law, the Negotiator law that's created. And so, you know, these are the two benefits that come to mind quickly. There's also the language and culture lawmaking power that provides, you know, the idea behind those two lawmaking powers is to really look at initiatives that will help to improve and strengthen the use of language. You don't have to be resident in the reserve to take advantage of some programs that might be offered to do that. You could have online training courses, Anishinaabe language courses, for instance. And then in terms of the financial management law power that's recognized, it would provide the reporting of the bands, the First Nations expenditures to everybody, regardless of where they live. So there's lots of ways that the people who don't reside in the community could benefit from the agreement as well, including the ways I just mm-hmm. just described.
And I think you stated correctly. You know, it's those are some of the things that could, because ultimately it's not spelled out in the agreement, or it's not going to be decisions made by the Anishinaabek Nation. What this agreement is going to provide is the tools and the resources for the local community leadership to provide services and access benefits to the community for those that live off reserve, but it's up to them. The power is going to the communities to be able to improve those situations. So I guess that, you know, that question would be directed at the chief and council of each community and not the Anishinaabek Nation. Once this agreement is ratified, I believe that's a fair question from members to their own chiefs and councils, you know, how are we going to benefit from this? What are we going to do that's going to improve things? Because this is merely a tool, so how you use it is up to the community themselves.
So the next question also relates with to citizens or members, band members, status and non-status, because you have here this question is, are we creating two classes of members, citizens and status?
Well, I think the the way the citizenship lawmaking power is set out, it's really designed to create, you know, one list of citizens afterwards. It'll include Indian status members who are already members of the community now. It'll also provide that, you know, if anybody's eligible to be recognized as a status Indian, they'll continue to be recognized as a citizen under the citizenship law. But you, Mary, you referenced your 10-year talk document there. And one of the things we heard during that 10-year period, pretty loud and clear from the people, was they really wanted to get away from having so many classes of status Indians. You know, 6-1, 6-2, S-3, really categorizing members of our community, not according to how we might decide, but according to a federal piece of legislation known as the Indian Act. And it's created some really awkward situations in communities where you have, you could have three children living with their mother in a home. Two might be recognized as status and one might not be. And so those things happen. They create a lot of division and animosity among our people and our communities. And so what the citizenship lawmaking power is about is having, you know, one citizenship list that's developed according to a citizenship law that's developed with the people, with consultation with the people on, you know, the kinds of rights and responsibilities and privileges that come with being a citizen of a First Nation. But the main point there is that it's developed in consultation with people both who live in the community and those that don't live in the community. But it's really designed to do away with the many classes that of Indians, if you will, that exist now under the Indian Act. So that's in time, that's what that's hoping to resolve, is that whole issue of so many different classes of Indians under the Indian Act, and have our own citizenship list that, you know, if you're a citizen of the First Nation, that's it, you're a citizen of the First Nation. There's no divisions into different types. So that's what's going on with that citizenship lawmaking power.
And somewhere down the road, I hope we do have the power as a nation to make our own determination who our members are, and it'll be recognized by Canada. That's what I'm hoping.
Yeah.
I think we all are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know we looked at, there was a membership code, where a membership code, you can be a non-status child, but under a membership code, you could still hold a CP to the land of the reserve. You can vote, you can live, but you're still creating two citizens, where one citizen, well, the gas pump can be tax exempt, where this one can't, but hopefully down the road we'll have that, our own power to make that determination.
I think, you know, I think we have to, you know, be honest about the complexity of citizenship. Nipissing's going through our own citizenship law exercise right now, and you know, just in the first you know, six months of this, we've discovered just how complex it can be, because in today's environment, when you have, you know, blended families, you have non-Indigenous people living among us that are part of our community. You know, we need as communities to establish, you know, what the rights are of all our citizens, Indigenous and non-Indigenous. everything from, you know, picking up garbage to a university degree. You know, we it gets very complicated when, an indigenous spouse passes away and the non-indigenous spouse remains in our community, as part of our community, has been there for a long time. You know, we don't stop picking up his or her garbage, or you know, doing their driveways if they're seniors. So it gets very complex when we start to actually peel back the layers of what our citizens, you know, who they are in our community. And you know, as a government, how much are we responsible for those citizens? Because, you know, we're not going to give non-Indigenous children of a blended family, education money to go to university. But we may want to be looking at, you know, just because the Indian Act says, you know, my grandchildren are not recognized as status, our community may still want to say, yeah, but they belong with us, and you know, so we're going to pay for that. That's just a scenario, but that's, you know, it kind of shows the complexity of what we have to look at when we're developing citizenship laws.
Mm-hmm. Who belongs and what kind of privileges and benefits come with that? Because there could be residency laws and then laws for people who are actually citizens.
Absolutely. You know, a perfect example is, you know, we have a public beach in our community, mm-hmm. and we have, you know, non-residents from the neighboring town coming in to use it and leaving a mess. So we put up a sign that said, band members only. Well, then we had, you know, non-Indigenous spouses coming and say, well, okay, so does that mean I can't use the beach? Right? So it gets that complicated. Like, it's almost splitting hairs at that point of how to deal with that stuff, right? But those are the realities in our governance system, in the communities.
So while we're on this topic, I'm going to go to this next question. It's a little out of order, but not the question, but I mean the order in which it was received. So this is also has a couple of assertions in it, presumptions, I think, that may not be accurate. I'm not sure. So having said that, do citizens have to be registered as Indians under the Indian Act? I think we've already talked about that. But then the rationale given for this question is, because all these membership codes require band members to be registered under the Indian Act. And then the commentary is, that is not an expression of sovereignty, but in reality locks us into and under federal jurisdiction. So it's got a lot of moving parts, this particular question, assertion. So I wonder if someone would like to tackle that.
I think, you know, when it comes to the Indian Act and the whole idea of status, and the way the Indian Act is written is basically to legislate status Indians out of existence mm-hmm. over time. Mm-hmm. And that's what it was designed for. And so when we look at our citizenship law, I think it is a practice of sovereignty, because when we create our own laws to say that, despite, you know, we're still going to argue about whether or not you are have the fiduciary responsibility for these citizens of ours, but I think just by claiming who is a citizen, a member of our First Nation, I think that's practicing. We're telling them who our members are, and the fight for the financial resources for education and all those other things is going to come after. But I think it really is an assertion of our jurisdiction to say that, no, these are our citizens here. And for an example, you know, a community may want to pass a one-parent rule that, you know, if one of your parents is from Nipissing or Dokis or whatever, then the child automatically is a member of Dokis in that sense. So, you know, I think, you know, this isn't, you know, I've heard so many times that they're saying, well, this is not being sovereign, this is not self-government. It wasn't intended to be full and complete, but what we're doing is trying to take the first step out of the Indian Act. And it's a tool, that's all it is. And I think maybe, you know, the name governance agreement has really not done service to us, because it's leaving everybody thinking that this is it, you know, this is self-government. But it's not. It's a baby step out of the Indian Act. And I think, you know, that is practicing more of our sovereignty than remaining under the Indian Act.
Okay, thank you. The next question is, if this law is passed, what does it make the Anishinabek Nation, I guess? And does the Anishinabek, so this is something that maybe needs some clarity from as well on the different bodies we're talking about here, or the people versus the corporate body. Does the Anishinabek Nation organization automatically become the governing body, and what does that mean exactly? So I'm assuming that the question means that first of all, I think we need an explanation between what is the Anishinabek Nation versus what is the Union of Ontario Indians, because it, as an organization, because there's this perception that the Union of Ontario Indians is going to automatically become the governing body. So perhaps we could speak to that, the difference between the corporate body and the Anishinaabe Nation.
Well, so what the agreement will do is it'll recognize the Anishinaabe Nation, which would be comprised of those First Nations who ratify the agreement. So they'll come together, and their elected representatives will form the Anishinaabek Nation government. On the Union of Ontario Indian side, it'll still exist as a corporation and continue to do the things that it does now.
Advocacy.
Advocacy and other functions. But the big difference is you'll have the recognition of a government known as the Anishinaabek Nation, which will be comprised of the First Nations, who will also be recognized as governments under the agreement. They'll come together to form the Anishinaabek Nation government with the powers that are recognized under the agreement. It'll be the chiefs who are elected under their election laws in accordance with the agreement, and they'll be the representatives of the Anishinaabek Nation government until such time as the Anishinaabek Nation government leaders put in place an election law under the agreement. But so that's what the big difference will be, is, you know, so one is a corporation recognized by corporate law and, you know, so limited in the things it can do, it can't pass laws. Whereas the Anishinaabek Nation government will be able to pass the laws that are recognized under the agreement.
I think perhaps the simplest way to explain it is nothing is going to change. The communities are still going to be telling the union what to do. It's not a transfer of power or anything like that. The power is still going to remain within the communities, and they direct. See, our government system is kind of reverse of that of Canada, where Canada is a top-down. And in our government, I see it as being a bottom-up government. So the people in the communities choose their leaders, and they dictate what they want their leaders to do. Otherwise, they get voted out. And then that goes up the pipe, and our chiefs tell the union what to do, and if they don't do it, then things change there as well. So it's a bottom-up government, and it really gets confusing, because when we're talking about governments, we always think about how the colonial governments work, and we get confused, but that's not how ours work.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's important to make that distinction. And really, at the end of the day, I don't see anything changing in the way of powers or decision making. It's not at all a transfer of that power.
Just another example, an easy one too, is the AES.
Mm-hmm.
We have 23 First Nations that signed on to the AES and 17 that haven't gone that route, but I understand there's going to be more. But there's a board was developed by the chiefs of those participating First Nations that give direction to the education arm of it, right? And then the Anishinabek side, we're still the secretariat. We still represent all 40 First Nations, not just the 23 or the 17.
Mm-hmm.
We still represent, when we're out for meetings with the ministries, we're representing all 40.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just another,
mm-hmm.
that's in process right now as we speak.
Yes. So I think what I've heard you say tonight, and you know, and with previous answers to previous questions, is that the Anishinaabeg Nation government is comprised of the First Nations that ratify the Anishinaabeg Nation Governance Agreement. So the Anishinaabeg Nation governing body that is a collective of those First Nations is a new body that is under the direction of those First Nations, as Chief McLeod said, from the people to the First Nation chiefs and councils, and then they decide what collectively they're going to do together and what laws they're going to have together at an Anishinaabeg Nation government. I don't like to use the word levels because it then presumes these ones above or the other, but that's not the way it is, because the Anishinaabeg Nation government is really at the bottom. With regards to the Union of Ontario Indians, it's an organization incorporated in 1949 to be the secretariat at the time for every First Nation in Ontario. The Union of Ontario Indians is a corporation under, I think, Ontario laws, under Ontario law that was put in place so that there would be legal recognition for First Nations working together collectively. It is a secretariat that actually functions under the direction of 40 First Nations. So my understanding from what you've said is that with these, in this sphere of the governance agreement, there are these four areas that are being recognized for First Nations to exercise lawmaking authority. All the other issues that we deal with collectively across Canada even, but particularly in our own territory, our own territories, those are the things that we could still bring to the Union of Ontario Indians as a secretary. Because that's what I thought.
Yes,
like I heard
yes.
you say.
But there's still things going on with mining, timber. It's still...
Yeah.
We're there, our region.
The secretary.
Right?
Yeah, that's
secretary.
Right. Thank you very much. So, now this relates to the Anishinaabeg Nation as well, this next question. So, how much money will the Anishinaabeg Nation be taking from First Nations if the Anishinaabeg Nation Governance Agreement passes? So, my understanding, that this person is writing, of the fiscal agreement says Canada sends money to the Anishinaabeg Nation, then the Anishinaabeg Nation gives money to the First Nations. How much will the Anishinaabeg Nation take off the top? So
under the funding agreement, the amounts that the First Nations are set to receive for performing the functions and activities under the agreement were set out in the funding offer that was distributed in June of 2019. So the Anishinaabeg Nation won't take any of that. It'll come in from Canada to the Anishinaabeg Nation and flow straight through. There's also costs related to the operation of the Anishinaabeg Nation government, however, and there's a range there that is available to operate the Anishinaabeg Nation government, depending on how many First Nations ratify the agreement. And so that's, I think, ranges from about 3 point something million to a high of 6 million, but that was negotiated separately from the funding that's available for the First Nations, so that it doesn't take anything away from the funding that the First Nations are expected to receive under the agreement.
So Marty, the amounts that each First Nation has seen from our assembly in Georgian Island, that's what they're getting.
Yeah.
Nothing's coming off.
Zero.
Zero.
Yeah. And that amount won't change depending on the number of First Nations that ratify the agreement. It'll stay the same and it'll flow straight through in the amounts that were recorded in the letters that were distributed in June.
Thank you very much. So now, I'm not sure that this is in the agreement, but by placing the funds in certain trusts, will it be labeled as own source revenue, resulting in a certain percentage to be paid to the Anishinaabek Nation? I'm not sure.
Well, the monies won't be placed in any trusts. They'll come into the Anishinaabek Nation. They'll flow straight through to the
communities.
The communities that ratify the agreement. So that's essentially how it would work. There will be trust.
And that won't be considered own source revenue.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a difficult question to answer because it's not clear what the question is, really. But no, there's no trusts, right?
Mm-hmm.
And none of the money that is transferred under the fiscal arrangements are own source revenue.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Now, the next one then will be, it's about membership codes. And this again relates to our citizenship section that's in the agreement. So after First Nations enacted band membership codes under Section 10 of the Indian Act, Ottawa washed their hands of any disputes over membership, which meant that individuals had to find thousands of dollars to bring their bands to court to resolve disputes. How will election and citizenship disputes be handled under the Anishinaabek Nation Governance Agreement? Will individuals have to find immense amounts of money to go to court to have disputes resolved, or is there another redress process?
So, questions of that sort would be resolved under our enforcement adjudication chapter, and what we've built up is the first way that could be looked at to resolve an issue related to membership or citizenship would be to just use voluntary services such as, you know, mediation, whether it's between the First Nation government and an individual. But I think one of the other ways we wanted to look at here was to build traditional Anishinaabek processes for resolving disputes, and there's no real framework on what that could look like. It really is going to be up to the community to decide what, you know, the traditional process could look like. The other power that's recognized in the agreement is the power to build an adjudicative body, a tribunal, where these kinds of disputes could be taken to. Again, there's no pre-qualifications on what they could look like, other than, you know, they'll be built using principles of natural justice and procedural fairness. But in terms of the composition and the mandate they'll have, it's wide open. It's up to the communities to build these things, to hear disputes or even hear appeals of things like election appeals, for instance, or maybe it's a citizenship law appeal. The agreement provides for the construction of those kinds of institutions, and that's where, you know, that's where those kinds of issues can go for resolution, which is, you know, distinct from sending them to, you know, non-native courts now for resolution. It just seems a bit.
And also, Marty, there is a growing need for our own First Nation courts. I know within the First Nation Lands Management Act, there are provisions in there that talk about establishing First Nation adjudication process in court. And just lately, we were speaking with folks there at the Lands Advisory Board, and there is a growing need now, because a lot of First Nations that are in the Lands Management Code are creating their own laws, and once you create laws, you need somewhere to adjudicate those laws, and so they've started to look in exploring ideas on how to work through that process. So I see this as all coming together at some point to fulfill the needs of the lands management laws, and now we've got the citizenship laws and election code and all these other things where those things can be heard, right? So I think it's in the foreseeable future where we're going to start to be moving into that area. At Nipissing, we have our own laws, from fishing to election to land code. And a lot of these non-Indigenous courts I've never heard of our laws. It'd be the first time. So even though there's provisions in these agreements, you know, to support them in non-Indigenous courts, it's very hard to get them in there. So having our own court system would only make sense to be able to adjudicate the process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mary might remember years during the same process when the RLJ was set up, there was different committees formed, and one of them was the Appeals Redress Committee, which all our First Nations had a member sitting on that, and they developed a template where if there was a dispute, it could be a round table of elders from each region here to dispute and try to settle it that way. So there's templates that we developed ourselves. Mm-hmm. They're still here. They just have to be implemented once everything takes hold. It depends how the nations want to bring this out, right?
Yeah. And I think the first step in is, you know, do what you said, Chief Scott, is just recognizing that because we're passing more and more of our own laws, you mentioned governance and education and, you know, the enforcement of your fishing law, for instance, in Nipissing, it just makes sense that we should be taking these kinds of matters to our own Anishinaabe-created institutions, which are, you know, include our own people on there acting as arbitrators or even judges someday, because, you know, you're right, you could be asking a non-native judge in a non-native city to somehow come up with some magic solution for the dispute that's at issue in the community, and they would never know about the law, would never even step foot on the reserve, and yet that's where we're sending these things to. So as we start to pass more and more laws, whether it's like the
matrimonial real properties,
yeah, the First Nation land codes, it just makes sense for us to start thinking about creating our own adjudicative bodies here, staffed by our own people.
All right. We have a lot of questions here still, and comments, a lot of comments as well. But it's 8:30 now, so we may want to move quickly along if we can. I know some of these are very complicated questions, but so who decided the amount of band support funding that each First Nation would receive if the Anishinaabek Nation Governance Agreement is ratified? Why aren't these amounts being released to all of the Anishinaabek Nation members in respect to all of the First Nations involved? So there's where is the financial transparency?
So the amounts that the First Nations will receive have been received by all the member communities, so that information is available from the band officer, chief, and council. In terms of how the amounts were negotiated, it was based on a number of factors, population, size of the community, but mostly I think it was based on the things that the First Nation will have to do under the agreement, enact the laws that are recognized and some of the support activities that come with that. So this information is out there, is available, and I would just encourage people to get a hold of their chief of councils, and that information is there.
Yeah, and some communities, such as Nipissing, have their financial management laws in place that guarantee transparency. But I think it's important to remember here that, you know, the amounts are, they're not real yet because the agreement hasn't been ratified. So, you know, in part of this is going to be establishing those transparency laws and whatnot, so band members can be, you know, ask the questions, you know, where is the money going, how much is being spent, and the leadership needs to be accountable. And some of the communities, like I said, in ours, those laws are already in place. At Nipissing, we're certified under the First Nation Management Certification, so we have those checks and balances in place. For those communities that don't, this will allow the resources and the power to create those laws and make sure that they're accountable to the people. So to me, this is a good thing, and you know, again, it's driven by the communities, and the communities are going to be the ones to let their leadership know that, you know, transparency and accountability is first and foremost, and rightfully so.
All right, so we have some questions here about constitutional powers, executive powers. Why are federal and provincial laws and authority being accepted? The imposition of the Indian Act and other laws breach Canada's own constitution under powers of the executive and powers of the provinces in the Canadian Constitution. This is what our nation should be advancing. We retain all the sovereign powers we did before the treaties. So I guess the question is, there's a bit of a statement there, but the question is, why are federal provincial laws and authority being accepted?
Okay, so the agreement where every lawmaking power is recognized, there's another provision that says right after it that in the event of a conflict between a First Nation law and a federal law that deals with the same matter, the First Nation law prevails. So it's not necessarily true to say that, you know, federal or provincial laws are being accepted. In most cases, it's the First Nation law that prevails in the event of a conflict between a federal law and a First Nation law enacted under the agreement. So, for instance, with the power to enact a law in the area of elections, it says in the event of a conflict between a federal law and a First Nation law enacted to pursuant to the law, the election lawmaking power, the First Nation law will prevail to the extent of the conflict. And that framework carries out throughout all the lawmaking powers that are recognized. Now, there are some federal laws that will continue to apply, though, because laws like you know, aeronautics and criminal code those kinds of laws will continue to apply because the federal government retains jurisdiction to enact laws in some of those areas, like the Official Languages Act, for instance, criminal code, aeronautics. So it's basically saying that the federal government isn't prepared to recognize any First Nation lobbying powers in those areas because they have national significance. So, and then in terms of the provincial laws, the provincial laws that have been, you know, deemed to apply in our communities, such as the Highway Traffic Act, some of those laws will continue to apply. But for the most part, the whole application of provincial laws is left for, if a First Nation wants to challenge the imposition of a provincial law, that's still possible under the agreement because we use the term applicable provincial laws, and leaving open the question of whether a provincial law is applicable or not. So all of which is to suggest that the provincial laws don't automatically apply. It really goes on a case-by-case basis. If a First Nation wants to challenge the imposition of a provincial law, it's open to do that. It's that avenue of redress is available under the agreement. So that's to make sure that when Section 88, the provision in the Indian Act says, you know, all laws of general application continue to apply, that leaves open the question of what is a applicable provincial law. So it's not automatic that provincial laws continue to apply.
And just to comment on that question and that statement, the imposition of the Indian Act and us removing that is exactly what we're pursuing. So it's not fully and completely, but it's the start in those four areas. And yes, it has been an imposition. It was not something we agreed to. And what we're trying to do is remove some of that. And in these areas, by us taking the lawmaking ability and the powers out of the Indian Act and putting them in the hands of our communities, is actually doing what that statement was, which was pursuing, you know, the removal of the imposition.
And I mentioned Lands Management Act. Mm-hmm. Some of our communities signed on to that, and they're taking those little pieces of the 100 lands in the Indian Act to look after their own lands. So the election code, that's section 74, that'll be pulled out. So little pieces, eh? But every First Nation across Canada is still under some form of the Indian Act, where we're starting to pull out little pieces under our own guidance. But Canada still has that obligation, though, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so now this is not another one of these questions is about the what's the agreement about? And this is something that we've heard a number of times, is that most of the rights under this agreement are already in the Indian Act. With that said, why change it just for more money? This is just a way to allow another government, the Anishinabek Nation, the power to make the White Paper 2.0 extinction a reality without looking suspicious. So maybe you might want to.
Well, again, I would just simply rebut to that by saying we're not giving the Anishinaabeg Nation any powers at all, and that the powers are remaining within the community. So, I mean, that's a bit of a red herring, in my opinion. It's not when we look at how the Indian Act is handcuffing us right now in those four areas. By removing that is not a step further into losing our sovereignty. It's a step forward. It might be a small one, but it's still a step forward.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else want to weigh in on that?
Well, just when you look at the election provisions of the Indian Act, for example. You know, yes, there are election provisions in the Indian Act, but part of the problem is everything that happens in when an election is held in a community under the Indian Act is beyond our control. We don't set the term of office. That's limited to your term of office under the Act. We don't set the qualifications of who can run for a councillor, who can run for chief. So none of that is in our control. And you know, as Chief Scott said, the whole point of this agreement is to get us out of that section so that we can have our control and more control over who our leaders can be and how we choose to elect them and the terms that they serve. That's what this is about. It's taking back our control over these areas.
And another piece that's missing now, Mary, is that surprised me that a question has come up around language and culture, where we're always hearing from elders, citizens, we got to protect our language and our culture. Well, under that $540 million, that's going to help us if a First Nation wants to bring in more education into their schools or into their community. They'll have the funds there now to do that, you know?
Yeah, under the Indian Act, besides the fact that there's no protection, there's not even any mention of language and culture in the Indian Act. And this allows our communities to create laws to protect language and culture.
And so, speaking of culture and traditional governance being one of them, there's a question here from someone is asking if there is an opportunity to reestablish clan governance and make decisions for the entire lands and waters that it represents. This person says, I'm asking from the context that the Dotem mark is on more than seven treaties. These land areas in the treaties do not necessarily align with current First Nation traditional lands. In short, how will the Anishinaabek Nation help us protect the largest waters and land areas? So it's asking about reestablishing clan governance and making decisions for the entire traditional territories.
Well, I think that's a bit of a complex and again, an area that kind of goes outside the limits of this type of agreement. I think that has to be done in conjunction, you know, with the treaty organizations that, you know, when you're talking lands and resources, you're talking waterways, those all fall within the signed treaties. And I think, you know, there has to be some crossover there of how these things are going to work. But essentially, I think the driving force behind the protection is of lands and resources is not necessarily going to come from this type of governance, but it's going to come from the treaty organizations to be able to protect, because those are treaty issues.
Thank you, Chief McLeod.
No, just what we discussed today, I think,
yeah.
A few decades ago, God bless her heart, she's passed away, but I think she's a member of Bowles and Lay. She said, even though there's a lot of our members not sure of our clans, we have to bring it back somehow,
mm-hmm.
and then take it from there and just build on that. So that's why we see different clans, that modernization, I guess, of the clans, where, say, social services would fall under the deer. That's what we're trying to develop people's minds around it, right? I guess, you know, if we want to run that way.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I remember being at that meeting with our elder. She was on the elders counselor, Merle Assan Speedy from Beausoleil, said that to reintroduce the clans and our Dotemite system, to use it in any way we possibly can. And she was saying, and even in our administration buildings, that we should,
mm-hmm.
as you said, Chief Marsden, is to do align, you know, our functions, roles, and responsibilities to each other in the community, and the clan system, of course, being a whole. It takes all of those people to make make a whole and to do the work for each other. So I recall that very well.
Mm-hmm.
So we have about 15 more minutes, I think. Is that where we're at? I beg your pardon? Martin? Okay. So there's a message for you, Martin, here. Came in. Okay. There's another one here that is there's a opinion that the agreement is saying that the inherent rights are aboriginal rights under Section 35 and that it is an outrageous position to take. Our sovereignty is not subject to Canadian federal decision-making powers or authority. So I was wondering if you might want to address that with regards to... I'll just pass that over to you.
Yeah, so the agreement the agreement is based on the recognition that the inherent right of self-government is an existing Aboriginal right under the Aboriginal Treaty Rights that are protected under Section 35 of the Constitution Act. And there's other parts of the Constitution that deal with Indians as well. There's a Section 9124 that deals with Indians and lands reserved for Indians, and the reason we take the position that our existing Aboriginal right to self-government is one of those rights is because it's in the Constitution, and there's other things in the Constitution too, like the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, and includes Section 25. But anytime we're heading to court, we have to rely on that provision as the basis for defending what it is we're trying to defend. We get into Canadian courts. There's no escaping reference to Section 35. It was our leaders actually that fought for that, that fought to have that included in the Canadian Constitution, you know, before and at 1982. Otherwise, we would have no constitutional recognition for our Aboriginal or treaty rights, and that's why we included language in the agreement that provided for the protection of our Aboriginal treaty rights as laid out in Section 35 of the Constitution Act, which reads, you know, the existing Aboriginal treaty rights of the Aboriginal peoples of Canada are hereby recognized and affirmed. Well, our leaders fought to have that wording in there in 1982. And so if we go to court and we want to defend an action we took as a First Nation government, we have to argue that it's one of those rights that are protected under Section 35, which again, like our leaders gave us back in 1982.
I think it's important to make the distinction that our sovereignty and our inherent rights don't come from the Canadian Constitution, but they're recognized and protected under that. So basically, we're using their word, saying that they recognize and affirmed it in their constitution. So we're making them live up to the recognition of our inherent rights and our sovereignty.
Can I just read a few points? This is the Anishinabek Declaration of 1980 by all our leaders. There might have been, I don't know, 44 back then of our nations that belonged. But number one, we are nations. We have always been nations. Number two, as nations, we have inherent rights which have never been given up. Three, we have the right to our own forms of government. Number four, we have the right to determine our own citizens. Five, we have the right of self-determination. Now, they're rights that we're fighting right now, and we're trying to take control. And number nine, the rights of Indian nations as nations must be entrenched and protected in the Canadian Constitution. These rights include Aboriginal rights. So this is the thinking back in 1980, 40 years ago, right? Mm-hmm. I think Patrick always mentioned that. You know, that's That's huge from leaders 40 years ago saying these things, you know.
And if I just may ask how much time we have left at this point?
It's 8:43.
Okay, so I think at this time, what I'd like to do right now, because we do have 15 minutes left, and what I would like to do is to give each of, but Martin, you have one, did you have a question in the shop or one that you would respond
to?
No? Okay.
It's just a statement.
Okay, all right. So what I thought I would do now is we have, let's see, how many of these questions? One, two, we almost got through all of them, and I don't think we're going to get through these four that we have left here. So what I would like to do at this time is to make sure we have enough time for our panelists to give their commentary just in general about what each of our panelists could give a final statement on the benefits of the governance agreement, and then after that, with just a few minutes left to go, I will let you know what we're planning next for you with regards to fielding questions and being available to speak with you in this wonderful world that we have here of immediate technology. So I'll start with our regional deputy grand council chief from the southeast region, Chief Jim Bob Marsden.
Ah, miigwech. It's been a pleasure this evening talking to the citizens that have joined us online, and just myself, being a past chief of Alderville First Nations for 15 years. I was in the governance process since 1996 under the United Anishinabek Council, plus the Anishinabek Council. I think I personally would never bring anything forward to bring harm to our citizens. I'd just like to make that statement. I don't think any of us would, and I think it's for the betterment. We're hearing different things out there about, we're Indian, but I think we're just trying to pull things out that we want to control ourselves. Citizenship's a big thing. We did the summit and the citizenship workshop. It was huge. People were interested. I brought forward, we got to get people to understand 6162 and non-status, mm-hmm. what it has done to our nation over the years under the Indian Act. And if we can just control that piece ourselves, we'll determine, instead of our members appealing to Ottawa, trying to get their status back, we'll decide that somewhere down the road, I hope, you know, Marion. And that's one of my biggest things, and I think a lot of our members, their experience in that field, Wayne Beaver from Alderville, then Jeanette Corby, another experienced person. I'd like to see another forum just to deal with citizenship.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
Thank you. That's a great idea. Chief McLeod?
Thanks, Mary. I guess, you know, I'll be totally honest and say that I'm not going to sit here and, you know, say that this is a perfect, by any means. But we have to look at this as a starting point. I remember when the land code was first ratified by some of the communities, and there was, I believe, only around 14 or so communities out of 634 that signed on. Today there's over 300. And those communities are not looking back. And there was no hidden agenda on those. There was no, when you look at the communities, at some of the benefits that they are experiencing from the land code, it was because, you know, it wasn't perfect, but they knew that it was better than Indian Affairs dictating what business would go on in their community and how they would govern their lands. This is much the same. I don't believe it's a full form of self-government or a full practice of sovereignty or self, you know, determination, but it is a step out of something that's been oppressing us for over 160 years. And I think, you know, by us taking that step, you know, it's going to be a lot of work, you know, once we actually ratify, if we do. It's going to be a lot of work, but it's going to be us steering the ship, you know, and it's not going to be the government telling them what we're supposed to do. So, you know, there's a lot of fear out there on taking these steps, but I believe it's the right thing to do. I believe that every community has to, look and see how it's going to benefit them. Get the real answers. Don't just rely on Facebook posts or do the research, ask the questions, talk to the people that are involved. And I look at it as simply as this. It may not be a full practice of our sovereignty or a true form of self-government, but staying dormant under the Indian Act is worse. That is not sovereignty. That is not moving forward. That is not doing anything other than just being comfortable with status quo. And we all know the Indian Act very well, and I think maybe there's some comfort in knowing what to expect, and there's some hesitation to move into something and that we're not sure of. But I look at it as, the decisions are going to be up to us on how this thing is going to look at the end of the day. And to me, that's more comforting than knowing some bureaucrat in Ottawa is doing it. And I fully and truly believe that. And, I think it's just that step that we need to take, to move towards what we once had. I think it's time. We can wait another 30 years and we're still not going to have a perfect solution, but I think now is the time for us to roll up our sleeves and get moving on this. So, Miigwech.
No, Miigwech. Martin?
Well, just to wrap up and close and say that, the agreement will recognize our inherent right to pass laws in these four areas, so elections, and I think that's an important power to be recognized, because just over half of our communities still elect our leadership under the Indian Act with its limited term of office, limited two-year term of office. So that's a lot of turnover there, and we have to provide an alternative to that. And so that's an important power that's recognized as well. Then there's language and culture. Two things going on there. One is the use of our Anishinaabem language is disappearing. It's not being retained, and we have to start doing something about that, because when we lose our language, we lose part of who we are. On the cultural side of that, I think it gives us an opportunity to use more of our traditions and our customs in the way we conduct our meetings, whether it's a community meeting or a council meeting. There's actually band council procedure regulations that are in place that set out how our agendas will unfold in chief and council meetings. And in those Indian band council procedure regulations, you won't find any reference to opening with an offering of thanks to our creator or using our shkipke, our medicine, at those meetings. And so by having that lawmaking power recognized, we'll be able to incorporate those changes. Citizenship is important as well, because right now we have, for the most part, the funding that comes into our communities is determined by the number of status Indians, and that list isn't getting any bigger. That's shrinking, and that's designed to reduce the number of status Indians out there. There's member communities that are having no more status Indians being born right now. And so with the citizenship lawmaking power, I think we have the opportunity to do, as Chief Jim Bob said, to have our own citizenship lists recognized by Canada by pushing for the time when we did determine who our citizens were, and we want to get back to a time like that. And the last power is the financial, you know, finance and operation type law. So the best example of that would be a Financial Management Act. And I think that's important to look at that as well, because there were questions about accountability and transparency. But more importantly, when we don't exercise that lawmaking power, then other governments' laws will apply to us, like, you know, like the Financial Management Act, and it'll impose requirements on us, like having to post our honorariums and our council's honorariums and salaries and travel expenditures and so forth. I mean, those can still be posted if that's what the community decides, but to force the communities to post that information, and then if they don't, then threaten to pull back discretionary funding, I think is completely unfair. So, you know, that would all be displaced when we have the power and exercise that power to enact our own financial management law. And so you know, some of the things we're doing now are laid out in the Indian Act now, but when we do those things under the Indian Act, we run up deficits. Our governance powers, our governance functions under the Indian Act are limited, and we have limited funding to do the kinds of things that need to be done. And so with the new funding offer, our funding will increase, you know, 7 times, and that'll make sure that we don't incur deficits in when it comes to governance functions under the Indian Act. And if there's any surpluses in terms of the funding that's provided, those won't have to be returned to Ottawa. Our communities can allocate them to other areas where they're needed. So overall, I think there's a lot of benefits to our communities under this agreement. And so I would really encourage everybody to, you know, to ask the questions and of course take part in the vote next month.
Mm-hmm. I regret. Okay. I guess in closing, I just wanted to say that we do have an Anishinabek education system, and there were 23 First Nations that signed the education agreement. We had been delivering education programs and services since 1972. 2016, we had this agreement. And so the one piece that was missing from that was the jurisdiction and the authority. And since that's happened, the reports are very good with the Anishinabek education system, that the Kinemotsman education body, the central body, is working very well. And right now we have 11 First Nations that are interested now in joining. So that would be 34 First Nations that would be coming together, exercising jurisdiction over education vis-a-vis that self-government agreement. And as we go into this vote, I think that there still is the, I see that the people, what I've heard is that we're doing a nation, this is about nation building, it's about moving forward. I just like to say that when I started working for the Union of Ontario Indians in 1995, we didn't have an eagle staff, a national flag, nor did we have a bundle. Very central to the nation building. So there we've made a lot of, I can see how the Anishinaabeg First Nations have actually made a lot of advances in making things better in our communities, which is what we always were working for. And I'd like to acknowledge all our dearly departed elders and the members of our communities that work very hard in both these processes for that purpose, so that we would become stronger in our language, that we would practice our culture, that we would have Anishinaabe identity, and that we would help one another. And that's one of the things I see about these collective bodies, is that it's a sharing principle, like Chief McLeod talked about, you know, using the principles, our traditions, our grandfather teachings. So those are the things that I have seen over the last 25 years of working with these gracious gentlemen and these dedicated leaders that we have and among our Anishinabek people, Anishinabek people. So, as we conclude, I'd just like to say that I'd like to say miigwech to all of you for taking the time tonight to join this live Q&A. And thank you very much for your questions and your comments and your assertions and all of the things that come with asking questions in the context that you're looking. So we hope we did give you some answers tonight. As we conclude, you know, I want to say that we'll have another opportunity. There are about three or four questions here about institutions, delegation of authority, some technical kinds of things. But we will have another Facebook Live Q&A on Monday, February the 3rd at 7 p.m. So we hope to have you see us then, and also we'll be taking your questions, and again, we'll be having a group of expert panelists and leaders and technicians to be able to respond to you live as we have tonight. So I'd just like to say thank you very much again, and on behalf of our panelists, say miigwech, and we'll see you next time.
Chi miigwech.
Chi miigwech.